It's over to my colleague, Bob Keough, and I hope you'll all enjoy this conversation. Thank you, Bob.
Great. Thank you, Laura. So this is our media panel, Media Perspectives, Energy Policy in the Trump Era. We've got a great panel here today that who are the people who report the news, and they're here to help us try to make sense of the news. This is the third time we've had one of these media panels between Energy Forward and our Pathway event in Sacramento, and I'm always a nervous wreck before the panels because I worry that I'm going to be the victim of breaking news, and all of my panelists are going to bail on me an hour before the panel because of the things that are going on. So I'm always grateful when I see my panelists actually show up. And today, more than ever, I think the world out there is really crazy. And where I want to actually start off the conversation today is just to ask you guys to tell us about, you know, what it's like to be an energy and environment reporter in Washington, D.C. These days. Valerie, why don't you kick us off?
Sure. Well, covering energy policy in D.C. these days is like drinking from a fire hose, because from the moment you turn on your phone in the morning, there's something else. There's something breaking. There are sources leaking you some information, or Trump has said this. Administrator Pruitt at the EPA, for example, this morning, question whether CO2 contributes to climate change. So every day there's, the entire day, the story changes, and there's just, we're kind of covering things on multiple fronts. And I think the other thing that's changed is just the level of interest from our readers in the story and from our editors. So at Reuters, there's tremendous interest in the energy story and climate story and the unraveling of these regulations, and even much more so than when the Obama administration was rolling all of these big programs out. So it's like the Joni Mitchell song, you don't know what you've got till it's gone. Now people are paying attention. The general public will now know what the stream protection rule is, where they might not have before. Now they realize that it's fine to allow a coal mining runoff into our waterways, and So the attention is there and the interest is there, and yeah, in competing with all these other many headlines happening, there's, I think, energy's high on that list.
Rod, I'm wondering, you were mentioning as we were talking at lunch about parallels to the Reagan administration. Have you seen this kind of tumult and in a transition before? It's not as if we haven't had transitions before.
Are you trying to get me to admit my age? I agree with Valerie, by the way. This is kind of like, for me, our reporters at E&E, it's like a combination of Groundhog Day and Christmas morning. Every day is the same, and it's like you get presents given to you every day. And it's so easy to do our job. But the parallels between the Reagan administration and this administration are very much in line with a president who was elected thinking that his ideology and his mandate was to dismantle the government, and to radically change the direction from the Roosevelt administration and the Great Society to do different things differently. And he hired again David Stockman, who was not unlike Mike McMulvaney, who was an ideologue about the budget. And as we know, DOE is still here. The Department of Education is still here. And I mean, there are forces beyond the checks and balances that are in the Constitution that play a great role in sort of preserving what I would say the good of what government does, the consensus good of what government does. And the other checks and balances are, it's us, it's the media, it's corporate America, it's you guys. I mean, the reason today why Rick Perry tweeted that he supports ARPA-E is he wants to know where his next job's coming from once he quits DOE. He wants to be an industry problem. No, I'm serious. I mean, the reason he's not going to let that go, because he knows the senators aren't going to let ARPA-E go away. But the other institution, aside from the media, and I guess you could throw in academia there, although I'm about to have an oops moment to forget my third example. So much like Rick Perry, but there are these other checks and balances out there the civil service, not just at the federal level, but at the state level and the regional level. because they all have skin in the game. They have jobs, they have families, they have mortgages, and they, and oftentimes, we're talking about this at lunch, if you're in rural America working for the federal government, they say an Interior Department agency or part of DOE, you are likely among the highest paid people in your rural county, because you probably have a master's degree or a PhD, and you're doing important work. And those jobs are critical to the survival of a lot of those local economies. And once again, a lot of rural senators, they may say one thing in Washington, but the idea of cutting back on staffing at a national park or Forest Service lands or a national laboratory, I just don't think that's going to fly. It didn't fly 30 years ago.
Krysti, you've got a small but growing team at Utility Dive. How are you guys keeping up with the news?
Well, there's been a lot of sleepless nights, and we are basically trying to sift through a lot of reports and figure out, all right, what is rumored, what can we check and confirm with the sources that we have on the ground, assign it to our reporters and our freelancers. If we hear a scoop, we try to have them snuff it out. But we mostly depend on a lot of the media reports to aggregate content for our daily briefs. It's been really overwhelming at times with the amount of news that you see on Twitter, the amount of news that you see just on social media. And I must spend the bulk of my day combing the internet to see what news is, what is the latest update, what can we add to serve our readers. And that can kind of take away from the basic day-to-day news about what's going on in the power sector. Our readership has grown very much since the election, and we have definitely seen an uptick in interest anytime we put the word Trump in a headline. Our readers want to know the latest updates because it is such an uncertain atmosphere right now with the news, with the leaks that are coming out of the administration. And so, you know, just keeping our pulse on just what's going on day to day is definitely a task for a small team, but I think we're doing a pretty good job, and I definitely admire all the reporters that are working so hard keeping us informed as well.
Jen, you're part of a big team at Bloomberg. How has life changed for you and your team?
Yeah, you know, I would say that there's this idea that everyone, the career civil servants, are eager to tell their stories, that they're coming to us with leaks every morning. And I would just put one fine point on that, which is that, you know, while there is, I think, an interest among all of these folks in sharing policy proposals that they're concerned about, in elevating some of these things to the attention of federal national journalists, there's also a lot of fear. I mean, I'm talking to folks within the administration who, you know, maybe they were comfortable talking on encrypted email or encrypted text, but even that has become strained. They're concerned about being found out, really, just running counter to, you know, what the politicals in their agencies are saying. So it's, you know, it's and at some point, you know, there is an interest in telling these stories, but at the same time, by the same token, these folks are scared of losing their jobs.
Yeah. Well, let's get away from the craft and into the substance. I think, you know, we're all here gathered from all around the country and into D.C. and trying to figure out what the Trump administration means for the advanced energy industry. You know, we have to start, like everybody else, with the America First energy plan up on the White House website on Inauguration Day. We look at it, and it's all about extraction of resources, coal, oil, natural gas. But it seems to me an America First energy plan ought to have a place for advanced energy, where we've got wind, solar, hydro, energy efficiency, energy storage. These are all homegrown American resources, but we don't see them there. What do you guys think? Is there room for advanced energy in the Trump energy plan? Jen, you want to take a first?
Well, I would say that, I've actually heard from a number of wind and solar developers who think that they have a really good story to tell to this administration. They're changing their message. I mean, when they went into the Trump administration pushing for policies to advance offshore wind farms or, you know, put more solar arrays out in the West, you know, they were pitching, obviously, their industry and their solution largely as a climate solution. Now, you know, they aren't talking about climate. They don't lead with that. If they're asked about it, they'll acknowledge it. But they're leading with jobs. You know, they're presenting these industries and these developments as a job story that ticks, you know, a lot of boxes for this administration. Not only do, you know, solar, wind, energy storage, do all of these things help create jobs, but they also, you know, they help with energy diversity, energy independence. I mean, these are things that the Trump administration talked about. So I think there is actual room to push these ideas. And I would say even on offshore wind, you know, even if this administration were to largely halt a lot of the work in that area in terms of federal permitting, you know, there's still a foundation that was laid by the prior administration, and developers in that area, for instance, can keep going. I also think there's going to be a lot of interest at DOE on clean coal, carbon capture and storage, and indeed on energy storage generally. So I think those are openings.
Just to sort of follow what you said, but go back to the America First Energy Plan. What this proves is that Pollyanna has an office in the West Wing. today, EIA reported for the first time ever in February, there was a gas injection into storage because there was so little demand for gas for the because of our warmer weather, and there was a little bit of room. Excuse me. This is the alarm telling me my parking meter is expired. I apologize. But there actually was a February injection of natural gas today in the storage, and that pretty much filled up the storage that we have now. Nick Akins of AEP, who I know you probably all have talked to, I mean, he says all the time, you know, those days are done and gone of building coal plants. We're never doing that again. There's not going to be a coal plant built in this country. All coal will be exported if it goes anywhere. And in terms of oil, the same thing is true, that the pipelines are full, the fuel, that the storage farms are full, because every time the new car goes on the road, it's using less of that right. commodity. And you can say you want to extract all the resources you want, but there's nowhere to put them, and no one wants to buy them. What people do want to buy, and you know there's a lot of your large customers of the utilities who are driving a lot of your businesses, they want to buy because they have sustainability policies, and they've got maybe actual skin in the game, like Google owning some renewables. They want renewables, and they're happy to go along with efficiency improvements. And they're being served well by the electric utility sector, by and large. There are a couple outliers who still think that they can burn coal for another 20 years, but for the most part, Southern Company, Duke, AEP, all the big ones are on board with sort of turning their backs on coal. So, I mean, this is just sort of wishful thinking, and I think it's unfortunate because it gives a lot of unrealistic hope to many people in states where Trump had a majority of the votes and where those jobs could be eventually, but they don't exist today, and we haven't seen an uptick in hiring, frankly, in the first 2 or 3 months of this year in those sectors.
The one thing that we do know is going to change is the Clean Power Plan. That we've been sent very clear signals about that. I think we're all expecting an executive order on this already, but it seems like it's going to be next week, and we don't know exactly what path they're going to take to get rid of the Clean Power Plan. But it seems pretty clear that they are. We've been as an organization have been very involved in it because we. See it as a market driver, something that would accelerate the growth of advanced energy, but also seeing it as based on some fundamentals that are not going to change. As Rod says, moving away from coal toward natural gas, renewables are growing at a fast rate, and customers are calling for it. Energy efficiency, still the cheapest resource available to everybody, and more and more picked up by the utilities. So I guess my question is like, well, say the Clean Power Plan goes away, and we assume it will one form or another, does that mean we turn back the clock, or is there going to be sort of an ongoing legacy of the Clean Power Plan? Rod, let's start with you. I mean, you guys, you with your power plan hub, you followed this.
The hub. Do you guys know the hub? Well, the hub's not going away. We're going to call it Power Plan Hub 2.0 because that's what's going to happen. The Obama administration Clean Power Plan is dead, but the Clean Power Plan as an institutional ethic within the industry is embedded. It's there. I mean, you know it. Your customers, you know it. The utilities know it. And that's a strange thing politically. There's a disconnect between those people who want to sort of turn back the clock, thinking you can do that, and the fact that, you know, what day do we not see a large announcement by a utility saying they're buying some merchant solar project or a merchant wind project? And they're doing that because they've got an IRP that says over the next 10 years we'll retire these three old coal plants. And they're methodically going through the process, and they're doing it because the economics are good now. The fuel is free forever. And as long as the technology maintains itself, the one thing we don't know about most renewable technologies is what's the half-life of a wind farm or a large solar farm? What's the degradation rate? And how soon they have to be, replaced or significantly maintained. But we'll learn that over time. That'll provide a lot of jobs too. But the Clean Power Plan, The sad thing is the red and blue state America thing is now, since when was energy political or electricity political? But now it's a political argument. And I don't quite understand how we're going to get past that as a nation, particularly when on Capitol Hill you still have this antipathy towards anything has to do with carbon, anything that smacks of ex-President Obama, and yet it doesn't seem to me like many members of Congress are listening to their own executives. Once again, I'll bring up someone like a Nick Akins or a Tom Fanning. I mean, these are conservative guys. I mean, they're business people, and they're doing what they're doing not because they love green energy or they don't like coal. It's because they can make more money.
The majority of the states that sued the EPA to challenge the Clean Power Plan were already very much on track for compliance. So that will continue. Those investment decisions have been made or in the process of being made. So I think the story goes on. They might not officially be because of the Clean Power Plan anymore, but they're on their way. So
I would also like to add that even though utilities are on track to invest more in renewables and they do plan on monetizing these resources, the decarbonization of the grid will probably happen at a slower pace than it would have happened if spurred by the Clean Power Plan. So that is one drawback to taking it out. But when I was at the NARUC conference, which is the a winter meeting for the regulators, state regulators that oversee utilities, one Arkansas regulator did say, hey, 4 years from now, we're going to wish we had some sort of carbon policy in place because they're preparing not for the next 8 years. They're preparing for what comes after the next 4 or 8 years if a Democratic president is elected and enacts stricter carbon policies. So it's interesting to see how the trend of decarbonization will slow down without the Clean Power Plan, but utilities are already factoring it in, and grid operators are already factoring it in to their planning process as well.
One of the topics that does seem to be something held in common by Republicans and Democrats and by the Trump administration and Congress is rebuilding infrastructure. Krysti, Utility Dive grabbed the news, fairly early on of a list of infrastructure projects that were being floated around the Trump administration. And it wasn't all roads and bridges. There were actually some advanced energy pieces in it. There was wind projects in Wyoming. There was transmission for wind and hydropower, energy storage and grid modernization. Is that a good sign for some sort of advanced energy component of a eventual infrastructure program?
Well, so a report did emerge from McClatchy about these infrastructure projects. I would say that it's too early to say if these infrastructure projects will make it under an infrastructure bill because we don't know what that's going to look like. I was talking to someone who was close to the Trump administration at NARUC, and he said that this report, which actually looked more like a policy consultant report, might not be what we're going to see when the bill actually comes out. What we're very likely to see is a series of tax reform that could spur $1 trillion in investment. That's what I'm hearing from our sources and from other reports. But renewable energy and these projects do enjoy bipartisan support within their states and even within Congress. So there is a chance that these infrastructure plans will be held in some consideration. But when I was at NARUC, the big talk around the infrastructure bill, however, was not around transmission lines or renewable energy. It was around interstate natural gas pipelines. A lot of utilities are switching out to natural gas as a bridge to cleaner fuel, and they need a way to ship supplies to their plants. So that's the talk that I'm hearing now. I would definitely say we'd have to wait until we see what an actual bill looks like. And whatever form it emerges, we can definitely count on it to be pretty controversial.
Yeah, it would be interesting to see how, Republican Congress deals with the idea of, well, we want to spend a lot of money on something, building something, and how that runs into the desire to cut taxes and to reduce the tax rate and all that sort of thing. Rod, what do you
think? Well, I just want to say that in talking to some utility executives in the past 4 to 8 weeks, they don't want any federal. They don't want the federal government getting in their business of building transmission lines. That's what they do. They a lot of them didn't take the ARRA money for smart meters because they just don't want any strings attached. Some are regretting that now. But the biggest issue with transmission lines, some of which were in the McClatchy document, is that they cross through states that don't want them. Arkansas is a good example. So until you solve the issue of Federal Power Act authority over siting, whether a FERC can have an override or some kind of combination with the states, those lines aren't going to happen, no matter whether Trump wants them or even a utility wants them. But I don't think you're going to see the electricity sector or really even the pipeline sector wanting to be tied down by expectations of federal appropriations coming through for in the billions of dollars. I mean, in waiting. I mean, they've got their good credit ratings. They've got their investors on Wall Street. They're ready to go when they're ready to go, not when the president tells them to. That might be different for dams and bridges and airports, but I don't think in our industry that infrastructure is going to really intersect much at all with any administration bill.
Well, and to your point, like the biggest thing that was discussed as possible funding mechanisms were public-private partnerships, which has been a popular partnership used in building out roads and water pipelines. You know, a lot of your representatives, there was a couple of representatives from Congress who spoke at NARUC, and there was even a panel on it at NARUC, spoke about figuring out ways to pair up with private contractors and build those infrastructure projects so they wouldn't have to depend so much on federal funding.
I want to turn now from some of these issues into sort of more the institutions, the agencies, and where we've seen things happening. Certainly, one place to start is the Department of Energy and the new Secretary, Rick Perry. Jen, before you were Bloomberg, you were reporting on oil and gas for the Houston Chronicle here in D.C., so you've been observing Rick Perry for a long time. What should we expect from him as a guy who's, you know, labeled an oil and gas guy, but also was governor during the biggest explosion of wind power in the country, and Texas now, you know, undergoing a solar boom as well?
Yeah, I mean, Perry is... all of these cabinet secretaries get much more interesting once they're actually installed, and we see how, you know, what they said on the confirmation, on the path to confirmation, how that ends up actually translating into policy or doesn't. And I think we're seeing early signs of that with Perry. So what's interesting about him to me is that, you know, in Texas, he viewed energy policy as a tool for economic development. And you know, all of the above, energy may be kind of an epithet in this town, depending on who you ask. But he really, in Texas, saw energy that way. He saw it through an economic prism, and that's a lens I think he still has now at the Energy Department. So, you know, for example, in Texas, not only did he sign legislation setting a renewable portfolio standard, but he also supported the Texas CREZ, a project that allowed transmission height, you know, transmission projects in the panhandle of Texas where there's plenty of wind but not a lot of customers. He set that in motion, helped set that in motion, and that's really one of Texas's success stories on wind. To the extent that DOE does play a role in accelerating permitting, streamlining some permitting of, you know, some of these high voltage transmission projects that cross multiple state lines, I can see him carrying that Texas approach to DOE and to those efforts. And I would say also, you know, we've seen a lot of evidence of him going off script, off message, certainly off the script that some of the beachhead team or the Trump transition advisors would have written for him. We saw that in his confirmation hearing where, you know, he talked about investments in advanced energy and ARPA-E and the national labs. And, you know, as Rod mentioned, he tweeted just yesterday about supporting, you know, the investments that come through ARPA-E support innovation that is critical for our advanced energy economy. So, you know, he's saying some interesting things there that I think speak to a more nuanced approach.
It's interesting that I think it's something that we find in our work, too, that the governors generally have that attitude toward energy as basically an economic question, not so much an environmental question, not so much, you know, they want to make the most of whatever resources that they have from the point of view of jobs, economic development. Well, we'll see what happens to them in Washington, D.C. Other thoughts about Rick Perry or what's happening with DOE?
I just want to piggyback on what you just said about the governors. You know, we have two recent examples of Republican governors taking steps on energy that are contrary to their own state's interest And one is a story I wrote for today, which is Kentucky's about to lift their nuclear moratorium. The coal industry has blocked that for years. And the Republican legislature, which is all Republican and Republican, they're saying to the coal industry, we're thinking long term. You may have a role now, but you don't have a role in 10 or 20 years. We want nuclear. And in Ohio, as you all know, Governor Kasich vetoed that bill that the legislature passed that would have really set them back on renewable energy and efficiency. Now that bill's back now with a lot of Republicans sponsoring it, but Kasich has said, I'll veto it again because it's all about jobs. So when you have Republican governors taking steps to sort of double down on looking at energy as, whether it's renewables or oil and gas or nuclear, as a job opportunity and economic development, that sort of changes the entire debate.
And the top 10 wind-producing counties or regions in the country are all represented by Republican representatives. So, I mean, eventually, I think this does become part of the dialogue when the dust settles a little bit. So if there is lip service paid to rural America, because it was so crucial in President Trump's victory, then it will be interesting to hear from those representatives and those voices.
And to kind of add on that, you have a lot of corporations that are setting sustainability goals, and they are moving into conservative states. Southeast is an up-and-coming one, and they're saying, hey, look, we want to build green energy, and we want incentives to do so. And so Republican governors are going to be more likely to keep businesses in their state than and find ways to keep them in and make it attractive than they are going to set roadblocks in their way. Especially for rural America, like states like the Southeast, which is very, very poor. So I think that is also starting to play a big part in seeing Republican governors change, or not change their minds necessarily, although some of them have, but enact policies that run counter to the historic party stance.
Yeah, and that was part of the message from Governor Kasich, too, in vetoing that bill and saying, look, we want these big tech companies to come into our state, and they want this type of energy. They care about the kind of energy they can get here. We can't send the message that they can't get that in Ohio and expect them to come here. So that I think that becomes another driver at the state level that you know, frankly, wasn't present 5 years ago. That's really changed very rapidly. Let me turn my attention to another agency, or in this case, commission, FERC. This one is just, Valerie, maybe you can start with a story here, but it's like, here's the Trump administration just putting in its nominations for cabinet secretaries, and suddenly FERC rises on the agenda. There's a change in chairmanship with an acting chair. Somebody resigns, there's no quorum, they can't do formal business. What the hell happened here?
It's still a bit of a mystery, frankly, why this administration chose in those early days to make LaFleur the acting chair, which I talked to plenty of folks who think that hastened the departure of Norman Bay. Now, the caveat there is I think I had heard prior to the election, had Clinton won, and had she elevated Honorable to be the chairwoman, that indeed Norman Bay would probably leave. But it seems like the appointment of, or the elevation of LaFleur, even on this acting temporary basis, certainly sped him out the door. And of course, you know, and I think the only motivation, or the motivation that was described to me by folks within the administration was, look, this shows that a new sheriff is in town. This clearly illustrates where we want to go with FERC. The unfortunate reality is that it also left them without a quorum. You know, while the agency, the commission staff can do, you know, some 85% of the business, there are some key projects and decisions they can't make. And it could be 6 months or more, even if we see appointments or nominations in the next few days, it could be 6 months or more before they're confirmed.
Yeah, and that is a question. We do have some names that are out there. I'm not sure that they're official yet, but the nomination process will begin, but it does take time. We're very much involved in a proceeding there that is going to move towards taking down barriers to energy storage and aggregated distributed energy resources. Very important for opening up market opportunities in the wholesale electricity markets for our companies and our technologies. Rod, how do they do business? Does this proceed, or is everything ground to a halt until there's a quorum?
No, they're doing business. I mean, they're doing a lot of business. And if any of you have yourselves or you have counsel here that interacts with FERC, you'll know that they're very active. I did an interview with the acting chair a few weeks ago, and she said, you know, we're taking in comments, we're doing an analysis. We're gonna have when we have orders ready, they'll be teed up and ready to go the first day we have a third person here. And there's really nothing. I mean, you've got a merger pending before FERC, but that merger may fall apart in its own weight. I mean, they actually have a couple months of breathing room, and in the meantime, they're doing the work that they can do. Cases are still proceeding before the ALJs. And they just announced this very important, significant, I think, technical conference for 2 days in early May that is going to go directly to the question of our state policies that are meant to encourage certain types of generation, whether it's preserving nuclear or solar RFPs, as in New England, run up against not just federal law and the, sort of the blurred lines between state and federal jurisdiction, but against what the RTOs now see as their legitimate role. And that's going to be an incredibly well-attended conference, and it's going to put out it should result in putting out several sort of paths forward for states and the feds, some that will include action at the state level, some that might include FERC recommending to Congress that they amend the FPA, but I don't hold my breath about that because most people in Congress don't even know what that the law says. But to get back to what Jennifer's talking about, the dismissal of Norman Bay was spiteful. I mean, that was sort of Trump using his heart more than his head, because Norman Bay was seen as an enforcement guy. He was an Obama guy. And he just ended up, frankly, the last 6 months of his term, he had levied millions and millions of dollars of fines on bankers, many of whom are now in the Trump administration. So, I mean, going after Norman Bay was deliberate. They knew he would quit, because he said, if I'm replaced, I'll quit. So they knew that was going to happen, and they're reaping the consequence of that. They don't seem to care, because I think they were just, it was part of the sort of the trend we've seen. The president retaliates against people he doesn't like. And I talked to Chairman Bay after he left, and he said he would have been happy to stay, but you know, they didn't even ask him. They just said, you know, they just named Cheryl LaFleur, and they informed him after the fact. So it wasn't handled the way typically those kind of things are handled. But FERC is proceeding. They're probably going to be fine through about June, and maybe by that time they'll nominate at least one person to take over as chairman.
Let's turn to Congress now. Certainly that's... President Trump is providing, you know, all of the entertainment factor for sure. But at the end of the day, a lot of things have to get through Congress and to actually happen. And this Congress has been waiting for a Republican president to sign what they wanted to do under Obama, but Obama wouldn't go along with. So there's certainly an opportunity of politically unified government to drive some change, and I'm wondering where we end up in our industry in some of those areas, like tax reform. Is there something at stake or something to be gained for companies in our industry through tax reform? I'm wondering about the semi-orphan Portman Shaheen bill that's been around for a couple of Congresses now. Wondering if it's third time the charm at this point, and what can we expect from the people in Congress who've been waiting to have the opportunity to drive an energy agenda. Who wants to start off?
Well, I mean, it's pretty evident. Nothing's going to get done until healthcare is done,
yeah.
And healthcare could take a very long time. I mean, you don't want to compare him too much to Obama, but in the first 100 days, President Obama did some major things to get the economy back on track. And really, there has been no legislative accomplishment yet. And so far, it looks like this Obamacare replacement that's been passing the House, probably the Energy and Commerce Committee today and past Ways and Means early this morning, that's dead on arrival in the Senate. I mean, this could take months just to do that. I don't think much, I don't know how much you'd like the Portman bill, but I don't think they're going to turn their attention to something like that. Next thing you're going to do is tax reform. They have dozens of nominations to go through the Senate that haven't even been submitted yet, and an infrastructure bill I think is frankly just a lot of talk. I don't think you're going to see that this year. I don't think they have their act together yet, because you've all read this in the papers. It's not a governing Congress; it's an opposition Congress. They're just learning now how to be governors of doing the job that they actually are supposed to do under the Constitution. So until they figure out how to be governing members and not opponents. I think there'll be gridlock pretty much. Just
and there seems to be some messaging bills that are kind of popping up there on their bills to, you know, transfer public land to state ownership that are cropping up, their EPA messaging bills. So it seems like there's a lot of bills that are just being discussed as a way to send a message or to put certain things on the radar, but they may not necessarily go anywhere.
Well, one thing Rod didn't mention in his list is we also have to fund the government. We have to do a continuing resolution.
That's the only
and the appropriations for the next fiscal year, so that's going to consume a lot of time and bandwidth. If they, I mean, what I see, the only opportunities I really see, and, you know, there's Congress can surprise us, it often does, but the real opportunities are really tacking, you know, getting a Shaheen-Portman bill or getting an energy bill or pieces of the energy bill from last year, moving on, you know, on some other vehicle. I think that's the real opportunity. I don't think standalone energy legislation has a huge chance right now, certainly this year, of getting floor time in the House or the Senate, but you know, for folks who, I mean, Representative Rob Bishop has talked about the infrastructure bill. We talked about that earlier as a vehicle for some things in the energy space. Representative Upton has as well, the idea that maybe you could take last year's energy bill and tack it onto an infrastructure bill, that there's a complementary role there. So I think that's where you could see some action, but it's not in a standalone way.
How about tax reform? That's another one that is out there as much trial balloon as it is, you know, actual proposed legislation at this point. It's something that the Republicans talk about all the time, but it's easier said than done.
I'm going to say something very briefly about that. The idea that you can pass tax reform in a matter of months is pie in the sky. I mean, I covered the 86 Tax Reform Act. It was called the 86 Tax Reform, but it started in 83, 84. It took several years. Because once you open up the tax code, everybody in town, you know, the people who like mohair and the oil, I mean, everybody's got a tax break. They zero in on that tax break, and they're going to preserve that tax break at any cost. And, I mean, yeah, you can talk about cutting corporate taxes and cutting taxes for the middle class, but it's the other stuff that bogs the Congress down. And, I mean, I would bet, you know, anybody here at lunch at Charlie Palmer's across the street, that you won't see a tax reform bill this year. You might see one introduced, but it's not going to get passed because the tax reform bill is going to be tied up very much in what Jennifer mentioned, the continuing resolution, the debt ceiling. It's all about it's all tied with the fiscal policies of the government. You can't cut taxes long term unless you find a way to sort of replace that revenue. Otherwise, you know, the Republican Congress in 2018 is facing what Trump himself said was is a bloodbath. So I just think it's a long term project.
Krysti, utility dive took a pretty deep dive, if I can say, and into the tax reform issues and how they might impact our industry. What are some of the pieces that we should be sort of on the lookout for? I mean, the one that has sort of surprised me, which is, you know, I think has some implications for our part of the industry, but big implications for the traditional sides of the industry, which is the border adjustment tax. Where, you know, you're suddenly seeing, you know, the oil companies saying, like, well, I'm not so sure about this.
Well, I can't speak directly to that, but in general, what tax reform could mean for renewable energy and for utilities in general, we could see a broad cut of corporate tax rates, which would make renewable energy credits, such as the wind production tax credit and the investment tax credit, for solar that were just recently extended at the end of 2015, less palatable to tax equity investors. And so what that will mean is that will raise the cost of capital for these renewable energy developers. And then to recover those costs, those renewable energy developers are going to have to raise their PPA prices. So that's not going to be a win-win situation for utilities looking to invest more in renewable energy and for renewable energy developers trying to build their projects. We're probably not going to see a direct attack on the actual renewable energy tax credits themselves. I say we're probably not, but there's always a fair chance we will. If this election season has shown us anything, it's that unpredictability is the theme. So if that happens, I doubt the wind production tax credit will come under scrutiny because it phases out completely. But the solar ITC eventually phases down to a permanent 10% tax credit for corporations. However, since utilities and major corporations can collect on that credit, we're going to probably see and push back against any attempts to roll that back. So at the very least, whatever tax reform comes out of it, it's going to be controversial and will have implications for how utilities and renewable energy developers look to cash in on their projects.
We're spending a lot of time here, and we are in Washington, D.C., so we want to talk about the federal government and federal issues. But we spend, you know, a tremendous amount of time on state-level issues. So much of energy is regulated at the state level, particularly the utility level. And one of our major initiatives has been working with the utilities and utility regulators to modernize the regulatory system for a business model that's more conducive to utilities doing business with advanced energy companies and incorporating advanced energy technologies. We've seen leadership in states like New York with its reforming the energy vision proceeding, but also many other states are going through grid modernization proceedings that also then implicate, you know, how it is that utilities make money, because at the end of the day, that's going to determine what happens and what does not happen. It's that's just the way this system works. Krysti, you guys at Utility Dive follow this process of a fast-changing, and maybe not fast enough for us, utility and power sector world. What should we be looking for in terms of what's coming? Where is action that will continue this process of opening up opportunities for a more conducive utility business model?
So grid modernization proceedings are definitely going to continue being a trend at the state level. Ohio just released their Power Forward initiative, where they're looking for ways to monetize distributed energy resources and incentivize utilities, basically give them a reason to say, like, this is a good investment. At its most basic level, these grid modernization proceedings are, whether directly or indirectly, a way to reform the utility business model and direct them towards integrating distributed energy resources onto the grid. And that's what we're seeing within New York, where they've probably been the poster child and taken one of the most ambitious routes and fastest routes to totally revise the utility business model. Others like Ohio and Washington, D.C., and Maryland and Massachusetts, and I'm sure there are plenty more that are going to be coming in this year that I can't name off the top of my head. They're probably going to take a not quite as a radical of a route, but they're definitely looking at ways to tell you to make utilities think about these investments for distributed energy resources or non-wires resources at the grid level. They're definitely going to be more of an emphasis on reliability and grid security, and there's going to be an emphasis on figuring out ways to use non-wires alternatives to replace costly infrastructure upgrades at the substation level. Whether utilities will see a return on it quickly enough remains to be seen. Con Ed just invested in a mobile battery storage program, project where they told us, well, we're not going to see a return on this, but it might give vendors a way to see opportunities in using this business model in other proceedings. Ohio is taking a different route in their grid modernization proceeding than a lot of them by saying, we're not going to have an end game, like the REV, which is basically saying, this is how we want utility business model to look. They're basically saying, we're going to open up this proceeding. You tell us how you think you can do this, and then we'll figure out where we want you to end up from there. So I definitely don't think we're going to see a slowdown at all. California is going to continue on with its reforms. Hawaii, of course, is light years ahead of where everyone else is in these proceedings. I think we're also going to see some action in Arizona. I was talking to the regulators, and one of them in particular loves energy storage, and so he's looking for ways to revise the renewable portfolio standard to include battery storage, and starting on small microgrid projects as well. So I think that all of the action that we're going to see with changes to the power sector are going to be driven at the state level. That's where we're going to see the biggest fights over incentives. That's where we're going to see the biggest debates over policies driving these resources forward. But so far, the trend has been that utilities are more willing to invest in these projects because they're seeing impact, and regulators are telling them they basically have to do it. So,
Rod, I'm wondering how this figures into the way you've been.
I thought that was a great analysis by Krysti, but it occurs to me that, you know, since the Clean Power Plan's gone away now, everything's devolved to the states, which most people probably like. Regulators, they're in power now, lawmakers, governors, even the utilities, who don't have to worry about working with Gina McCarthy, as nice as she was. But what you're going to see happen with these dockets that Krysti's talking about is you're going to see the argument about picking winners and losers devolve to the states. Because there are going to be people, I mean, it's going to end up, if the rev model is going to create some real winners in New York, it's also going to create some losers. Now, it's going to get through in New York because of New York's politics, but when you see that happening in a state like Ohio or Pennsylvania or Michigan or Illinois or Indiana, I mean, there will be more of pushback from people who see their ox getting gored. And that'll be interesting to see. It'll be harder for us to cover, frankly, because it's going to be, you know, potentially, you know, 10, 20, 30 states over the next several years going through this process, trying to figure out how to satisfy what's economically best for utilities, what customers demand, and what's pushing up against the traditional defenders of free markets or people who are still supportive of coal jobs. So, I mean, you're going to see this argument we had at the federal government for the past 48 years now devolve to the states. It's going to be a lot harder for us to cover, frankly, but it ought to be a challenge that we should be up to.
It's something that I thought that we were seeing sort of a convergence of the Clean Power Plan and the utility regulatory reform. Now Clean Power Plan goes away, but we're still having those dynamics that I think are driven by technology. I mean, that as the our technologies get cheaper, more powerful and effective, you know, people want them, and regulators want to figure out how to bring them in, and they don't fit very well with the traditional utility business model, so something's got to give. All right, well, I want to throw it open to the floor here and see what questions we have here. We've got a couple of folks with mics here to help you pose your questions. You know, this is a chance to turn the tables on these guys. You know, they're usually asking us the questions, but now you get to pose the questions to them.
Thank you. Read all of your Jim Steps with Direct Energy. I read all you guys, so appreciate what you bring us. Talking about the state, federal jurisdictional questions, I guess any other thoughts on sort of where FERC's process will go, but also thinking about some of the litigation that's ongoing now around some of these large subsidy programs in different states, and kind of your thoughts on how that ultimately works its way out, if there's any insights that you guys have on those conversations. And elsewhere, other states that are considering it, what do you think the politics in a place like Ohio and Pennsylvania are right now? And can the gas industry ever come together to sort of promote itself in a way in these states like Ohio and Pennsylvania to sort of slow down the subsidy programs?
It's like six questions.
I have more if you want.
Do you want to go first?
Sure. I'll tackle the large subsidy program question because that's the one that I think I'm best suited. Rod probably could tackle the state jurisdictional stuff. But in terms of the large subsidy programs, we're definitely seeing a lot of pushback within New York and Ohio in particular, where generators aren't as bullish on these ideas because it will make it harder for them to compete. But you are having these carbon goals coming in place, or you're having possibly stricter policies down the line, or you're having utilities facing potentially stranded assets that they can't sell, but they still have a lot of use that they need to find. They want to find a way to keep using them until they can retire them and not lose whatever revenue they generate. So I think we're going to continue seeing the debate on that. It's hard to say which way the wind will flow. I think I personally think that we're just going to have to wait and see, are other states going to follow suit and enact their own large subsidy programs? You know, Illinois is one example as well with the big energy bill. And then I know New Jersey, Ralph Izzo is bullish on saving his nuclear fleet as well. So we're going to see that pop up. And I think we're going to continue seeing it play out until, and I think it will mostly be at the state level, since FERC punted it, the Ohio subsidy case back to the state level. and how regulators want the baseload fuel mix to look like?
FERC really can't do all that much to solve these, answer these really large questions that are being asked in the marketplace. So we've had a series of court decisions, like the Hughes decision in Maryland and the demand response decision, that are sort of making iterative law on a lot of these questions that your industry is concerned about. The chairman of the House Energy and Commerce Committee is going to start hearings this year that are going to be like baby steps, or is getting his members to understand what the Federal Power Act is, what PURPA is, and why, in particular with PURPA, there are some utilities making a lot of noise about the fact that they're buying power now at premium rates that they don't need, and which is anti-consumer in their view, and they have a lot of allies at the state level, whether it's AARP or the state consumer advocates. But those arguments are very difficult to explain to members of the Energy and Commerce Committee when they're worried about Obamacare and whether or not it's going to be a tax bill or an infrastructure bill and all these things that are on their plate that are not so esoteric, but really no less important or no more important. So the reason FERC's doing this May technical conference is to sort of set the table for what the issues are, what's uppermost in the minds of state regulators, generators, transmission owners, so they can sort of get a menu out there of here's what's in the realm of the possible that we could do. Here's what states could do. I mean, in North Carolina, Lynn Good is counting on the regulators there to solve their problem by shortening the time of PURPA contracts, because she doesn't have any faith that FERC will take any steps to do that, even when they get a quorum. And once they do get a quorum, by the way, those three new members, they may be people who know about energy, if they're the people we think they're going to be, but they have to learn to work together. And they also have to learn to work as an independent agency, not as an arm of the White House. So, God, from my point of view as a reporter, I wish I had another 20 years in this business, because this is just great. I mean, it's never been more chaotic. But I'm glad you're reading us all. I'm sure we.
Hi, Mike Jung with Silver Spring Networks. It's been a long time since we've seen the headwinds blowing in the or tailwinds blowing for the folks who advocate for retail competition. Do you think conditions might be ripe for a return of that thinking?
You'd have to be in the right market conditions. I mean, the places where retail competition tend to exist now are in some of the RTOs, not all the RTOs. I mean, it's not prevalent in MISO. And in the places where it is prevalent, there are caps, and there's also because of the how quickly wholesale prices are going down, large customers want a better response from the retail provider in terms of price. It's not going to happen in the Southeast or Texas or the West. If I had to look ahead and think of what's going to happen with markets generally, it won't be at the retail level. It'll be the creation of a Western RTO probably in the next 2 or 3 years. There'll be some serious discussion about that. Retail competition where it exists, it's okay, but frankly, prices are so low. I mean, retail competition was instituted at a time when prices were high. Wholesale prices were twice what they are now. But as they keep going down, 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 PJM's prices this past quarter, I think, the lowest they've ever been. They're less important. It's why a lot of large companies like Dominion have gotten out of the business of being a retail supplier.
Questions? Anybody this side of the room? Lisa.
Lisa Francis with Advanced Energy Economy. I think our industry has been great at communicating through the media about the importance of some of these issues like business model reform, grid modernization, to each other. But reaching the more broad public through mass media, I think, has really been lacking. And having people really understand what these issues are and why it's so important, and making the connection to the more common public that aren't engaged in these issues on energy on a day-to-day basis. Do you have any thoughts about how we can reach more the public more generally on some of these complicated issues that most people who aren't in it day-to-day can understand?
Simplify the jargon. I had a very interesting debate with my aunt during family vacation about time of use rates, which...
Religion, which, politics, time of use rates. Really off the...
And it encompassed two out of the three. They're not religious. which somehow led into a debate over how much, say, the government has in how they manage their energy use, which actually was informative to me. coming from the power sector and writing for B2B media, it's really, really, really hard to get the general public to care about these issues until it really impacts them in the wallet. And I think it would really, I mean, I know I don't write for the mass public anymore, but when I did, my biggest issue was how can I get people to care about why the sage grouse matters in the great scheme of things. I was a reporter out in Wyoming for a bit. And really human-driven stories were the way to do that. And so it really falls on the shoulders of like Reuters and AP for them to not only dissect what these complicated matters mean, but also put it in a way that my mom can understand. I have more leeway at a trade pub where I can use more jargon. I can't imagine trying to distill that and try to present it in a way that people understand without getting something wrong.
Yeah, I mean, because I went from writing for a trade pub to writing for a wide audience, and just, you know, I still have to remove jargon out of my copy, and then, and it's, you know, it's a habit I've had to overcome. But I think it's finding people on the ground and around the country who can tell the story in a very interesting way. It's talking about jobs, you know. It's, yeah, you need to find interesting, I think the trick is finding a way to find the right people to have a good narrative to share, you know, with a wide audience, and yeah, no jargon.
My response, Lisa, would be you need to aim your message more at millennials than anybody else, because they've actually grown up as a generation of people who actually care about carbon, they care about sustainability, they care about saving energy, they want to drive a zip car. I mean, it's ingrained in the way they were raised and the way they've come out of young adulthood. You're not going to be successful with people of my generation. And the reason for that is that the United States has never been in a position where it's been so prosperous in terms of its energy diversity. I mean, we're almost self-sufficient in North America entirely for fossil fuels. I mean, nuclear's not doing that well, but we still have 90 plants. I mean, the price of wholesale power and natural gas are at almost all-time lows. And, you know, the price of gasoline is fluctuating, but it's still way below what it was back, even right after the recession. So people don't think about energy, as long as the light switch works. And so you've got to, you know, for you to sell people on choices like time of use rates, where they want to put a Nest meter in, you know, I think you have an audience for that, but I think it's a very young audience, and it's a well-educated audience, but it's a very small audience until there's a crisis. And that could be another blackout. It could be, you know, a cyber attack. Something's going to happen eventually. It always does in the scheme of history. But and then maybe you can capitalize on the fact that you hold the solution to part of the problem. But I think the challenge for your industry is really very great, because you know, we're so lucky to have low prices and abundant energy of all kinds right now that nobody seems to really want to think about incrementally how they're going to save a little here, save a little there.
And the coal industry has been effective in highlighting people, highlighting the plight of the miner, and they've been very effective in making the demise of coal story about people and how does this affect this coal miner in eastern Kentucky. I think they've been able to drive a successful message, or at least get, you know, a lot of media attention. They've made it a people story.
I also think that part of the story is about consumer choice. So it may not work for everyone in here to talk about rooftop solar, but I really feel like, as a consumer of news in this space, and as someone who talks to family members far flung and folks around the country, it just feels like the notion, you know, to the extent that you can tie grid modernization and battery storage and power storage to, you know, you have more choice as a power consumer, I just think that is really compelling to a lot of folks. I mean, I just feel like there's a lot of excitement around that story, more so than anything else I've covered in the electricity space. And I would also say there's an Elon Musk effect. I think folks care about the gee whiz, you know, there's a gee whiz factor to a lot of this. And I think millennials especially get that. They appreciate news and anecdotes and even policy stories that are driven around technology and where we can go.
Speaking as the only millennial on the panel, I can attest that is the case. But I've also had really, so caveat, I grew up in a deeply conservative family down in Alabama. I was homeschooled, so it's been a very interesting thing for me to like step out and like report on energy and then carry those conversations back to my family, because we talk a lot about these political issues. And one of the things I brought up was like, well, energy, electricity, Bob, what do you think of rooftop solar? She goes, I can't afford it. And I was like, well, what do you think of community solar? She goes, that's a pretty good idea. And I think word of mouth and really knocking on people's doors, the old-fashioned community connective way, is a really good way to reach people who are out in, like, the Southeast or in the boonies where I grew up. You know, it really depends on, like, your local reporters really understanding what's at stake, but also, like, if you want to get your message out, like, really talk to the people that are going to be directly impacted by the rates. And they will listen, you know, as long as you can put it in a way to make them enjoy listening, because they like the idea of controlling their own energy, and they don't like the idea of high energy electricity bills. Our time of use rates, apparently.
Well, I think we're out of time. I want to thank our panelists, Jennifer DeLuey from Bloomberg News, Rod Kuckro, E&E, Krysti Shallenberger from Utility Dive, sorry, millennial, and Valerie Volcovici of Reuters. Thanks, everybody.